to record the vital signs, blood pressure, respiratory, the oxygen concentration, temperature. These are all basic things we need to assess it. A very primary thing we have all communicate to students, and we all read it, and that these are trauma cases. So, which includes airway, whether it is obstructed or not, breathing, suppression, disability, then exposure to the patient. So these are all these purposes, because to identify that what is causing immediate death to a patient, the airway obstruction, the breathing difficulty, and severe external internal hemorrhage. These are some of the very important things which require an immediate attention. In a road traffic accident, if you see that if the patient is very critically ill, there are the we call golden hours. The first 1 hour of the trauma, we call it golden hours period. In that period, we need to be very careful and attentive. And if we, there are in this period, you see there are critical patients where nearly 20% or somewhere around 20% patients, they die within few minutes of this accident and trauma. And it is because there are injury of the major blood vessels, there may be cardiac rupture, there may be major damage of the central nervous system, or the respiratory damage, which leads immediate death. And in those patients, hardly we can do anything. But there are patients which, once they survive from this, then there are, if the trauma, the extent of trauma is not that, then the patient comes with these, may come with these, you see, few things, and where we can act upon and do certain things where the patient, the position of the patient, and we can put the patient, and then you see, if there is an obstruction in the airway, we can, you can make it patent by tilting the chin, and you see, lifting the chin, so that and the air can pass freely. The tongue which fall on the airway, it get extended. Once the neck get extended, the airway get clean. We remove the foreign bodies. I remove the froth and water or salivation, whatever it may be, and then we give an oxygen to the patients for immediate. So this is a kind of a thing, you see, which we can see in our in a road traffic accident. And but if you look at our own traditional system of medicine, we may not have a kind of a management described in text in that manner, because as I understand, you see, that this road traffic accidents were not so common on those days, you see. Probably it was the war traumas. There are animal, say, fall from a height, and the injury because of due to the animals, they are more common, or the war injuries are more common, you see, rather than bite and beating by blunt and sharp instrument. Therefore, a vehicle or a vehicle with speed, what you call this kind of a trauma injuries, are relatively less on those days. But they have given some techniques to remove foreign bodies from the throat. The technique to remove foreign bodies from the throat, initiate forceful coughing, sneezing, and by putting a tuft of hair into the throat, that initiate the reflexes into the coughing and sneezing reflex, and remove the foreign body may be removed. A tracheal foreign body can be removed by a blow given at the back, or the use of a nadi yantra. That is quite interesting, you see. Sushrut has designed a large number of tubular instrument which he has used for three basic purposes: to number one, to rog darshanartha, to see the disease inside; achushanartha, to suck something; and kriya saukarya, that means to operate upon it, you see, to look inside, to suck the material and to remove foreign bodies or to operate inside the body cavity. So similar kind of a tubular instrument, a nadi yantra, he has used to remove foreign bodies from the throat. And for that, he has used a very specific technique. He used a long shalaka, a probe-like instrument. On the tip of the probe, he see if it is a melted foreign body, can be melted easily, then a hot shalaka is introduced into the throat inside the nadi yantra, and the foreign body is taken out. On the other hand, if it is a non-melting foreign body, then a wax is placed into the tip of the probe, and then it is taken into the throat, and the melted wax is placed over the foreign body, and then it is taken out. So it's a technique what he has found suitable on those days to remove the foreign body from the throat, which causing obstruction into the air passages. The other instrument he used, a kankamukh yantra, which is having a long beak. You see, I mean, kankamukh is a bird's name where the beaks are quite long. Means this forceps has long blades, and with the help of the long blades, one can go into the deep and can remove the foreign bodies from the throat. So airway obstruction, he also described that airway may be obstructed by holding the neck firmly. It is because of due to strangulation. The strangulation by firm hands or by a rope or by a creeper. So the neck can be strangulated, which completely reduce the flow of air, and the victim may unconscious, and the patient discharged from the mucus with salivation. So these patients, he has advised certain medicaments to manage after this, if the patient gets strangulated and if the patient survives only. Well, you see, the another situation which happens in acute trauma is a circulatory failure. It is because of due to this hemorrhagic shock. See, which is bleeding, you see, the patient need to be assessed whether the sign of hyperperfusion, confusion, lethargy, pallor or cold or extremities, weak or absent of radial or femoral pulse, tachycardia and hypotension. These are some of the reasons of this circulatory failure, or there is a because of due to hemorrhage. The primary things to be done in this situation is to arrest bleeding. The first step to arrest bleeding is the application of pressure to the external wound. And then at situation, if internal wounds are there, especially in fracture, maybe a splint and possible application of a splint and fracture, or sorry, a bandaging are suitable to reduce or minimize bleeding in fracture cases, especially in femoral fracture. So, but if you look, you see, in Ayurveda, the philosophy seems to be the same, you see, what we can see in today to arrest of bleeding. So the proper bandaging should be done in traumatic injury of asthi, snayu, and shira. So that is one of his first philosophy. If there is a injury, cut injury, that is what he said, chinnu. If there is a injury of, I mean, cut injury of bone, snayu, and shira, if they get cut, and appropriate bandaging should be done to reduce bleeding and to stabilize the wound. This is one. Then in addition to this, he has also said there are four different principles of hemostasis that includes by sandhan, skandhan, pachan, and dahan. Sandhan means to unite something, you see. Skandhan, to apply cold for hemostasis. Pachan, these are drugs which helps in hemostasis. then naturally it's a burning, it's cauterization. So if you cauterize, the bleeding will be very steep. So these are some of the major sandhan has a very wider meaning. United, you can unite the margins from where it is bleeding. You can unite the vessels where it is bleeding. So you can also, there are drugs which helps in uniting this. So there is a variety of procedures which involve sandhan karma. So Ayurveda has given that immediate management is a bandhan, to apply a bandage, apply a pressure so that bleeding can be arrested. And there are other procedures, as I told, that there will be sandhan, skandhan, pachan, and dahan are the measures by which one can arrest bleeding. Blood has been given a tremendous importance, you see, by Sushruta. And as you can see that we are completely dependent on blood, you see. Our body, if blood is lost, the life will be lost. See, if blood is lost, so the patient may develop, see, the patient will be pale, there will be cold and clammy bodies, the breathing will be cold, and the eyes will be, see, they will be reddish in color, you see. And if the patient is come with this kind of a clinical presentation with a internal bleeding, so you may see the prognosis of these patients are very bad, you see. So that is why he said that these patients may be diverted. You may leave these patients. I mean, they need to be explained that their prognosis are bad, you see. Therefore, they realize that if there is an excess of bleeding, you may not be able to save the patient.
Hello, delegates. We are having some technical difficulties now. The session will commence soon.
So you can continue.
Yeah, yeah. Just I do not know. There was some problem probably in communicating with you. I'm really sorry for not to audible. Is so what I already talked to you that this importance of blood and the blood transfusion. It's a bit of a history of blood transfusion. What I was trying to communicate that there is a philosophy behind importance of blood, and blood loss should be restricted in all by giving all means, and if there is a blood loss, it should be replaced. The earlier our ancestors, they used to ingestion of blood for replacement of blood, but now we do not do it. Now we have a more safer way of blood transfusion, which has come to us sometime 1901, and in our country it was 1942 we started first blood banking, you see. Now, in a critical care patients, wherever there is a blood is required, so we use a blood banking or blood for patients, you see. As I told you that in acute trauma patients, there may be injuries at many places, you see. As I told you that abdominal injury is one such which is common at times. And I'm going to talk about this, how the abdominal injuries are being dealt in our traditional medicine. Due to trauma, they have divided abdominal injuries in two categories. One, a wall injury, the other is abdominal wall injury associated with visceral injury. Try to differentiate these two situations. One is a simple wall injury, the wall, abdominal wall is injured, and the other situation, abdominal wall in association with the injury of this other viscerals. And he has dealt all this separately. So due to trauma, if the intestine comes out without luminal injury, it should be cleaned thoroughly and should be properly in the abdomen and should be placed properly in the abdominal cavity. He has given an importance, you see, that because probably on those days, they do not have a privilege of having anesthesia like this, what we get today. Now our anesthetist friends, they make the patient not only anesthetized, but safe anesthesia as long we wish and keep the muscle relaxed. Therefore, it is quite easy to put the intestine inside. Those who do not practice surgery, they may not realize it, you see. Because if you practice surgery, you can realize that if the anesthetist keep the muscle tight, you won't able to put the abdominal organs, I mean especially the intestine inside, you see. It will be very difficult. Therefore, this happens in earlier days when, you know, at the beginning of our career, when we used to have ether anesthesia. So just if you take out the ether, the patient get conscious and the abdominal muscle get very strong, you see. You won't able to do anything. The same thing happens that if you are not careful in putting the intestine in right manner, I mean, if you have twisted them and then you put it inside, there will be obstruction. So that is again a deadly problem. So look at these all very minute observations. They are a very practical observation. If you do not practice surgery, you will never realize it. Therefore, they did these kind of abdominal injuries and they clean the intestine with milk. Of course, we do not, of course, and nowadays we don't use milk, but we use a normal saline to clean it because of a better understanding of body fluid. Therefore, cleaning is done by normal saline, and once it is clean, then the intestine, the foreign bodies are removed, then the abdomen, the intestine is placed inside the abdominal cavity and the abdominal wall is sutured. And care should be taken not to twist the loop of the abdomen, loop of the intestine, so that the patient should not develop a further problem like obstruction. If the intestine has perforated, after a proper cleaning, the perforated side should be repaired by clipping. They used a biological device, what you call. This was a question which was very often discussed during our period. And my teacher, Professor Deshpande, who was called the father of, the living Sushrut, we used to call him, because he was developed Sushrut in this modern, he developed surgery in Ayurveda in modern days, you see, in a post-independent era of our country, you see. We all are the disciple of Professor Deshpande, to whom now you can see most of them are the disciple of Professor Deshpande. So he used to say that, why the clips, why not the suture? Sushrut was quite, you see, if you see his armamentarium, surgical armamentarium, you can see that Sushrut has a needle, very beautiful needle, Dhanurbakra carved needle. He developed a traumatic needle, Budapas, what you call, you see. He used, you see, many type of sutural material like sun, like silk, like a fiber from our own body. So if he has so many things, then why he was so fascinated for an ant head, you see? It was probably, he explained it like this. This is not those who practice surgery. Nowadays, we have a better communication. A patient get injured or traumatized or have a perforation which is due to some disease, maybe sometime due to enteric perforation, maybe other reasons, you see. Maybe due to obstruction, the intestine get ischemic and perforated. So in that situation, the patient used to come to a doctor after a period of time, not immediately. By that time, the intestine get inflamed and fragile. It is quite easy to handle a freshly traumatized intestine and where suture can stay easily. But if the intestine get inflamed, it acts like a wet blotting paper. Means, have you seen any wet blotting paper? See, if you try to lift a wet blotting paper, it get torn. You cannot take out a wet blotting paper. Same situation happens if the intestine get inflamed and it becomes fragile. Therefore, suturing don't stay, it get cut through. Therefore, probably it was one of the reasons that he used a biological device, a clip-like device using an ant. So by approximating the ruptured intestine, the margins are approximated and clips are used, which remain at its position quite a long duration of time. By that time, the intestine get healed up and the perforation get closed. Of course, that was the explanation what he used to give to us. That it seems to be more logical to me also. So therefore, these are some of the reasons, you see, that how to handle a perforated, non-perforated abdominal injury and a abdominal injury with intestinal perforation. And then, see that what you can see, that if there is a perforation, so if there is a leakage, there is a peritonitis. So what he advised, that if you see more detail of the surgical procedure he has opted, he made a left paramedian incision infra-umbilical, below the umbilicus, and which is around, need to approximately 4 angul from the midline. So it is a paramedian site, you see, in the lower abdomen. You put an incision and then you come out, take out the perforated site, you then close it, and then you glute it again, you see. He has also advised a similar kind of a procedure for obstruction of the intestine also, where he advised that the fecal matter or the foreign body which causes obstruction, you milk it and you press it down so that the patient can pass through stool. That was his practice, what he did on those days. That one. But nowadays, we do not, if there is a perforation, we just simply repair them by using suturing material. But this suturing material was there with him also. He did not use it because this is a fresh wound, you see, fresh injury. But these patients used to come to him after a period of time, which become inflamed, and that was probably the reason he used this thing. As I told you that in intestinal obstruction, maybe in another surgical emergency where he did the similar kind of a procedures, as I already described you, the abdominal wound, then once you put an incision on the left side. But I must admire, you see, his precision of diagnosis, because I must explain to you all that being a resident, I have seen that we have a less, you see, a facility for diagnosis in earlier days. We have operated many cases of gallstone diseases, considering him there is a gallstone, because there were on the basis of symptoms, and on the opening we have found the patient have a normal gallbladder. So this may happen, you see, because we are not sure, because nowadays we have a ultrasonography, CT scan, which almost nearly 100% confirm the presence of stone is there or not. But this was not a situation in earlier days when these facilities are not there. So you need to merely depend on some other investigations, which are many a times there is a false positive tests are there. So like in cholecystography was done earlier, where many a times the cholecystography, there was no dye in the gallbladder, and which is one of the sign of inflamed gallbladder or biliary gallstone was there. So we opened and we found that there are, the gallbladder was normal. Similarly, in intestinal obstruction, we have a X-ray nowadays. So we've confirmed most of your diagnosis by presence of, by doing an X-ray or ultrasonography or CT scan, but these facilities are not there. Therefore, exactly they have to be very precise for their diagnosis and very accurate before opening the abdomen on those days, and they have to open the abdomen at a right place, the right place on the left paramedian side, take out the part of perforation or the obstruction, repair it and then replace it. So that was a very, you require a very specific and accurate diagnostic and technical knowledge for doing such kind of a surgical procedures. Suture is another important aspect. Without suture, as I told you, that you can't do any surgical process. Here a lot of suturing material, you see, needle, suture and suturing material, and did a lot of different kind of a suturing types, you see. These are all we know very well, you see. I'm not going to so discuss these issues. So in spite of that, see, we did a small study on these, you see, using this suturing material, Guruchi, Sun and Murwa. A very strong fiber, Murwa is a very strong fiber. Guruchi, the fiber is such a long, but their knotting capacity is very poor. But but the very important aspect that they reduce inflammatory tissue reaction and the wound healing is much better. Sun is a fiber which is used for making ropes and also for suturing. So these are biological fibers they are used, all biological fibers they are used. We did a study on animal, and what we found that the Guruchi, they have a very poor knotting capacity, they break very easily, their fibers are thick and unsuitable for suturing. But the Sun and Murba are suitable for suturing. But the interesting component is here that if you put the extract of Guruchi on the fibers of Murba and Sun, the tissue reactions are much less, you see. Therefore, we need a specific spinning technique to create a better suturing material out of the plant products like Sun and Murwa may be used as a suturing material. And if we add Guruchi on these, the local tissue reaction and wound healing are much better. This is an animal study which we carried out. Use a clip, they are already being done by many people, but now clip-like materials are being used for repair of, laparoscopic repair of peptic ulcer perforation, what you call a U-clip, you see. These clips are used, they staple and by using a needle, of course, and they are clipped, you see. And then they stay in proper, I'm sure in days to come, in future, there will be many more, you see, newer suturing devices, stapling material will come, which will be almost like a Susuta's concept of closing the abdominal wounds or a perforated intestine. Now, if you see the acute cranial injuries, interestingly, the Susut has given a tremendous importance on cranial injuries, and he has divided with this cranial injury in two categories. One category he has divided, cranial injury with intracranial damage, where there is a flow of blood and CSF is there. The other category he has described, there is a cranial injury, but there is no it is simply limited to the scalp and the bone. There is no intracranial injuries. So the prognosis are quite different in these two categories. Of course, the second one is much better. But he has not left these cases, you see. He has taken the first category also and given an ingenious very device, you see, for treatment of these acute cranial injuries. The cranial fracture without leakage of CSF, his principles of management are quite simple. He just simply advocated bandage, local bandage, and application of Ghrit and Madhu for managing wound. Ghrit and Madhu is being used extensively in Ayurveda for wound management. See, if you see, if it is a fracture associated with the leakage of CSF, you know that there is a continuous leakage of cerebrospinal fluid. So the patient will die because due to lack of intracranial pressure, and they plug the hole with a tuft of hair, so that the patient must not lose any more CSF, and there should be bandaging. And gradually, once the wound started healing, gradually a few hairs to be removed, slow one after one. After a few days, a few hairs. Then after a few days, a few more hairs. Like this, gradually the hole will be smaller and smaller, and the cranial wound will be healed. That was his ingenious technique on those days for treatment of cranial injury with loss of, where there is a intracranial injury is there and there is a loss of cerebrospinal fluid is there. So you protect it and allow it to heal gradually. And that was the technique what he opted, you see, on those days. Ophthalmic injury is another area. I mean, there are a lot of areas he has described. It will be beyond the scope of this one lecture, you see, to cover all these areas. But I am trying to say some of the important areas, you see. Again, if you see the ophthalmic injuries, he has divided in two areas. The traumatic association with laceration of damage of the globe. I mean, there is a vindanetra. Vind means where the cavity is drained, the cavity is broken up, cavity is damaged. Here the cavity is an eyeball. The eyeball is damaged, means there is something coming out from the eyeball. So that we call a damage of the globe. The other condition, the globe remains intact, but the globe may come out. There is a, what you call the laceration or evulsion of that eyeball. That we call avinnanetra. This one is a vindanetra, the another is avinnanetra. If you see, there is a damage, complete damage of the eyeball, you can't do anything, you see. In due course of time, the patient loses its vision. How do you know that? If you see that the patient has lost his vision and damaged the eyeball, hardly the victim cannot see anything, any object. So that is probably lost, you see. You have nothing much to do in these cases. But if there is an ocular trauma without injury of the globe is not injured, but it is lacerated. The eyeball has protruded out. Yes, you can handle these patients with utmost care in subluxation of eyeball without intraocular damage. The eye should be repositioned in the orbit with gentle pressure without damaging the muscle, nerves and vessels. These are the words given by Susu. After successful deposition, the eye should be bandaged properly along with suitable local medication. And he advocated place a lotus leaf on top of it and application of Ghrit, medicated Ghrit, for prevention of infection and ulceration on eyes. That was his advocation. And one can regain his vision and the eye. The vision as well as the indriya, both can be regained. The principle and treatment management of similar even today. If you see, this is a case report what I found today in a journal that the same includes a successful reposition of the globe into the orbit. What they have done in this patient, it was a bicycle accident. The orbit become prolapsed. So what they have done, they push the orbit, the eyeball into the orbit, and detect. The second objective of this is to detect and repair the damage of extraocular muscles. You see. Then the second line, what this says, the search and repair of the lost extraocular muscle is usually difficult and often futile. Look at, because the eye gets such a lacerated at that point of time, repair of muscles usually very difficult and not to be, and usually futile. That was the observations in even today. Therefore, that only thing is that it is simply to reposition of the eyeball into the orbit and a proper bandaging and care of, so that the patient should not develop ulceration, infection, keratitis, ulceration of the cornea. So this should be protected. You see, this timely intervention in this patient, you can save the eye and from the trauma of the enucleation. So this is a eye patient. What you can see with these simple measures, the patient can be managed effectively. The principles and philosophy of Sushrut, what he has described. Fracture and dislocation. There are many more issues, you see, which needs attention, you see. But I'm sure, you see, some of the issues has already been dealt by many of my earlier speaker, and it is beyond the purview of many of these areas to discuss in the same manner. So fracture and dislocation, this is another area where the Sushruta's principles and practice are even exactly the same way are being opted. The burn also, the drowning, poisonous bites and strings, acute pain in many areas, maybe in abdomen. I'm going to talk right now in another area which was not a true immediate life loss, but can cause a life loss if you do not take appropriate care. These are surgical emergencies or infectious. This is a necrotizing fasciitis. Dr. Hemant also took some time to discuss this earlier. Also, I'm going to discuss this area because it created, it helped us to develop a new things you see in Ayurveda, which is quite unique and interesting in the development of wound management. Necrotizing fasciitis is a life-threatening, progressive, rapidly spreading infection located in the deep fascia. Usually, these are the organism, Vita amyloideticus, ganglion. They are also named, you see, they are usually we call flea-eating bacteria, hospital gangrene. What you can see, there is an extensive damage, you see, which may happen in lower limbs, in abdominal wall, and in genital and perineal areas are the common, you see. Because this, we have at Banaras Hindu University, we have a center for excellence for treatment of anorectal diseases. Therefore, they receive a large number of patients starting from this perineal sepsis. And you can see that an abscess which can extend to the areas which are much beyond the local areas. The local area is quite small here, but you can see that the black spot, the necrosis, the gangrenous area, the infection has spread through the facial layer and to the abdomen and to the groin, then to the umbilical area. And you can see the flanks also. So this causes serious consequences, and very rapidly, if you do not take care, the mortality, you can see, it varies between 15% to 50%. That is where it comes, you see. It was again a French scientist, a doctor, Jean Alfred Fournier, you see, who described this, and on the name of him, the Fournier's gangrene is named again, you see. He was first to describe this Fournier's gangrene, and this Fournier's sign also there, you see. He has contributed in many other areas also. See, in this, it was usually the comorbid areas, diabetic patients, the elderly patients, obesity, this, the other diseases, they develop this kind of a problem. It may happen into these perineal and subscrotal areas. The reason, if you see, the anorectum is between 30% to 40%, urogenital, again, 20% to 40% cases, skin and genitalia, 20%. These are the commonest areas. Originally described in idiopathic gangrene, but now approximately we identify the reason is around 95%. We can understand from where the disease has started now. See, now, you can see that it is a disease, he had a small abscess not treated properly, so there is an extension of these areas and can develop a very extensive dangerous deadly septic condition. It can a kind of a mixed bug, you see, this microbial, a large number of polymicrobial infection, both aerobic, anaerobic, gastrophagic, and sometimes fungus, they all involved together, you see, and what it caused a thrombosis of the blood vessels, spreading of the infection, and extensive tissue damage. They are the basic things they cause, and what you can see that there is extensive tissue damage, and this extend to the various areas. There is a blood vessels, they get clogged, they get blocked, and you can see, if you see a specimen, so on an open, once you open the, you can see this all blood vessels. If you cut, there is no bleeding. So that what you suggest, that the blood vessels get blocked, coagulated. These are the area which happens very commonly in these areas. The whole area get involved, you see, in these areas. Well, you see, these are some of the critical situations. I'll just tell you, yeah. See, why this is important for us? Because normally, you see, these patients, if you do not take care of them, they die. Majority of them, they die. Maybe some 50% people, they die. But if you take care of these patients, we have able to make them survive, you see, almost nearly 100%, you see. And that is, again, probably in a very microbicidal drugs, using without microbicidal drugs in many patients. So the principles of management, it involves the early debridement, surgical debridement, cleaning and dressing, then secondary rehealing and reconstructive surgery by split thickness or pedicle graft. I'm coming gradually, you see this. We need a resuscitations at times because these patients are toxic at times, then a proper fluid and electrolyte balance, maybe antibiotic, empirical antibiotic is used. Now I'm coming gradually, what is the value of this kind of a treatment, you see, antibiotic. This life-saving measures, again, it is very important, you see. As I told you, this maybe patient will require at times this life-saving measures. Routine investigations, electrolyte fluid, because they lose fluid, blood and blood supplements may be required at times. The immediate surgical debridement, that is prime importance. That what we have developed here, that we have debrided the patient immediately once the patient is resuscitated, and then there is irrigation of wound. We use a punctovocal cloth, you see, where it soothes immense improvement in these cases immediately. In few patients, antibiotics are not given due to impaired renal function, resistance, and poor sensitivity and socioeconomic status also. The high nutritious diet. Punctovocal is a very common drug to all of us. We know it very well. It shows antibacterial, antifungal activities. And as soon as this treatment started, we debrided, the toxin get released, recovery rate within 48 hours, the general condition improves very quickly, you see, once you do it. And once the wound, irrigate the wound continuously, at times, and sometimes, you see, two or three times a day. And if you see that, if you see the results, you see, in these patients, once you debridement, then we irrigate these patients, you see, these all patients are being taken like this. So, for the now I'm coming, you see. Say a thorough debridement with excision of the dead necrotic tissue, irrigation with punctovocal cloth, and the patients are urethral catheter was passed in patients. These are of some 36 patients. The data I'm just reading to you, providing to you. All the patients are managed in the ward with daily irrigation for 20 minutes in lukewarm water.
Hello.
Yes.
Anjare avada.
A solution of punctovocal decoction followed by dressing with gauze piece in packed with 5% solution. The wound culture, antibiotic and other isolation organisms, and it took after 40 to 72 hours. Once the healthy granulation starts, you see. So these are the patients where we did a continuous irrigation of the wound once the debridement is done. And you can see that after the 55 days, such a necrotic wound, these patients get completely a granulated healthy wound, and subsequently, see, there is a variety of area get exposed, and we have recovered them, you see, by with a secondary closure. Architect, we have closed this area with a thigh pouch placement of testes, split thickness skin graft, pedicle graft, and fasciocutaneous flap are being used to closure of these areas. This is a case where there is a spontaneous closure was done, secondary healing. Here there is a partial scrotal testicular excision and followed by scrotal graft. This is a partial thickness, split thickness graft for penile graft. And then you see, you can see also this scrotal that we have used a pedicle graft, you see, to cover the testicle. And you can see this is the result, you see, what we have obtained. We have not used a split thickness graft because the scrotal sac to provide a cushion to the testes, we use a pedicle full thickness skin graft by using the same technique what Sushrut has advocated. So this is during the process of treatment, a pedicle graft was taken. Subsequently, the pedicle we removed from here and the scrotal sacs were This is another case, you see, where you can see there is an extensive necrosis, and this is a day one. Then subsequently, we were debrided and used the same drug for debridement and healing. Panchavalkal is being used. This is after 15 days. These patients were without any antibiotic. And on 25th day, that what you can see, the whole region 29th day. So you can see a patient who came on 0 day with a extensive damage, and only after a month, you see, you can see that there is a complete facial damage. You see, you can see through and through, the muscles components are there. So there is a complete healing of this entire area with a mobility of the joints are completely restored, and this patient is now suitable for skin grafting, you see, and we subsequently. Considering this immense efficacy of this plant, we developed a wound healing patch, you see, using this panchavalkal, a biodegradable patch, where panchavalkal is impregnated on a biodegradable matrix and is used for wound healing. And now this micronized powder being used, these nanoparticles are prepared, and these nanoparticles are impregnated on a biodegradable template. You can see that once it is used, this wound healing patch get automatically degraded. It need not to remove it, you see. Once you put it into the wound, it gradually dissolve and the drugs get released into the wound. The drug also stimulate new cell formation, you see, on experimental model. And on animal model, it shows a much better healing than in compared to the control and other drugs. See, this drug is used on a biodegradable patch. The drug is impregnated using a electrospinning technique where the drugs are impregnated in biodegradable template. It is useful not only in these kind of a wound healing, also in other diabetic foot ulcer and also in venous ulcer also. So you can see that this drug is efficacious even in, you need not to remove the dressing material every day. So why I took this opportunity to communicate you that this kind of a dressing material, which can be used even in very serious life-threatening infection, can control the wound infection and can see not only save the life of a patient, also it is, you see, useful and a low cost treatment for many a country like us, where you may not be able to spare a lot of money for a poor patient. So this is one such area, you see. Once we start working this area, maybe more newer things will come out. Why, you see, this I am now next, these are some of the areas which I have tried to discuss, that the principles and philosophy of Ayurveda are being used as such in some conditions. There are philosophy are there, the techniques have changed, but the philosophy has remained same in critical care and in emergency care. Now, why BHU model is a model platform for integrated care? See, before going to this, we need to realize, you see, that the founder of this university, the great university, Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya ji, who offered Bharat Ratna in 2015, he has a vision document when the university was established. His vision was that there should be an Ayurvedic hospital in the university, but the Vaidyas must be trained in contemporary science and medicine. That was his vision. Not that the only limited to the traditional knowledge. Therefore, he appointed doctors from modern medicine for teaching and training. That was the basis of that, where a traditional system of medicine, Ayurveda, as well as modern medicine, they become together. They join hand together in this university system of education, which is probably the first of its kind in our country. And then you see, these things get momentum when Professor K. N. Udupa was basically an Ayurvedic graduate who came and joined Banaras Hindu University. And he did his formal training of modern system of medicine, did his FSCS, and also worked extensively in organ transplantation and wound healing. He joined the university as a director, founder director of this Institute of Medical Sciences at Banaras Hindu University. And he became a bridge between the modern and Ayurvedic system of medicine. And he did it. He was the person who did first renal transplant in our institute in the northern part of India with a team of both modern medicine and Ayurveda together. And Professor P.J. Deshpande is one such, who is basically from, who is our head of the department and our teacher, is one of the team member on that renal transplant. So you can understand, it was done during 1968. So long back, when we are not in the university setup, we have not joined in that time. So during that period, a system of medicine where both Ayurveda and modern medicine get an opportunity to work together. And with the vision of Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, who had a dream that the Vaidyas must have learned, must have trained with modern contemporary medicine and science also. Professor Udupa established a research laboratory, so what we call him a surgical research laboratory, and both the Ayurvedic and modern people, they work together to establish various philosophy principles of Ayurveda, and did a research work not only in modern system of medicine, also in fundamental principles of Ayurveda and surgical principles of Ayurveda. What he made, a coordination between Ayurveda and modern medicine, that is probably more important. We do not believe, normally if you see that we always have a question that Ayurveda may not do it, you see. Ayurveda aadmi nahi kar sakta hai. But this is not true in this university system, where the people, they understand that there is a coordination between the people. The people involved from the both system of medicine in emergency and critical care. Till long time, you see, after the establishment, this Ayurvedic people, they are involved in providing anesthesia and critical care in Banaras Hindu University hospital setup, and they are regular part of all surgical procedures, anesthesia, critical care procedure. Therefore, people gradually tune and learn things, you see, when living by working together. Building trust, that is probably one of the best thing, you see, that people trust each other. None of my modern medicine fellow ever hesitate to refer patient to an Ayurvedic surgeon, that the patient will not be in a safe hand. That is probably most important. The other important thing, that being a same administrative setup, the The university hospital has a common director. Therefore, being a same administrative setup, the training of residents in allied discipline of medicine is possible. A resident doctors from an Ayurveda can have a training with its allied discipline if a resident desire or if a doctor desires it. So there is an interdisciplinary approach when a patient comes to, when patient care is concerned. As I told you that many of our colleagues of modern system of medicine, there is a referral system exists in this hospital that a modern medicine consultant can refer a patient to Ayurveda. A Ayurveda surgeon or a doctor can refer a patient whenever he or she requires a consultation from another discipline, allied discipline, or another department. So there are therefore these all interdisciplinary approaches, a understanding with each other, trust building, respect to a individual system of medicine that built up a better relationship between doctors of both system of medicine, where people can work together when these issues. The another important aspect that the department, you see, in Ayurveda, these due course of time, the Ayurvedic doctors, they are quite tuned and capable, and they learn and develop courses for anesthesia and other allied disciplines which are essential for existence of surgical practice. Nowadays, without safe anesthesia and life-saving measures, no one can do a critical care assessment, critical care of the patient. The people from Ayurveda, in due course of time, they are trained and educated and develop courses for our own people for anesthesia, for safe anesthesia and patient care. And there is a department was established, Department of Sangyaran, to provide anesthesia and critical care services to the patients which are being treated by the faculty of Ayurveda. But unfortunately, due to some regulatory problems, this course has become withdrawn, which you all know. They not only provide anesthesia services to us, also they regularly conduct CCPR, you see, this cardiocerebral resuscitation program regularly, and till date they started in 2000, you see, which is probably one of the most important aspect of our department when the department was not an independent department. It was under the Department of Shalya Tantra. The workshop on cerebral resuscitation program, the first workshop they started on 2020. Till now they have conducted 60 workshops has completed. More than 500 participants from all over the country has trained. They have trained even, you see, the medical staffs which are not paramedical staffs, other medical doctors from they are not attached to the institution. They have published books on CCPR on certain things they have also taken from Ayurveda and also from the contemporary knowledge. Now they have started a 6-month certificate course on CCPR and first aid at university level from 2020. Now they have also started certificate courses on Attayik Chikitsa and intensive care from this year. So these situations make the students and the residents aware about this. So critical care need not only a theoretical knowledge, also they need a practical knowledge. See, what I have seen, that even if you have a theoretical knowledge, if you do not have enough skill, you do not have enough coordination, you may not be able to handle a patient. You see, people will run here and there and they will create a mess of it. You may not be able to participate step by step. The surgical specialties in Ayurveda at Banaras University, there will be a department of Shalya Tantra, which we exist, and there are many specialties under the Shalya Tantra, general surgery, endoscopic surgery. We have a very extensive, you see, area of anorectal surgery. We have a wound clinic, urology clinic, and radio imaging. These are some of the areas through which critical care and emergency care are being provided. The pain and palliative care, the department of Sanyaran, and they provide anesthesia services in addition to this pain and palliative care, and also Agnikarma as a specialty. The department of Prasuti Tantra also extend obstetric and gynecology services around the clock, and also deals with obstetrical emergencies. The department of Shalaka Tantra also deals with ophthalmology, surgical procedures in ophthalmology, ENT and dentistry also. They are gradually developing dentistry now. So with these, you see surgical facilities, but this backbone of these all surgical department always remain as a safe, life-saving, safe anesthesia for performing any surgical procedure, which is an emerging area, which is an essential area. So as a matter of fact, the take-home message to all of to my participants, that emergency conditions are integral part of the medical practice and cannot be specific to any particular system of medicine. In today's medical practice, irrespective of the system of medicine, during the period of treatment, many diseases at any moment, emergency situations may arise. At that point of time, life-saving medications, measures are essential to save precious human life. The damage, if we do not take care, the damage the patient. Similarly, in certain emergency situation, a patient may present with critically ill conditions like road traffic accidents and others, and poisoning, etc., where immediate life-saving medicines and measures are essential. In such situation, the practicing ASU system of, the IU system of physician or an established hospital with their hospital setup cannot deny their responsibility from providing immediate life-saving measures to the victim on account of ethical or moral ground. It's a basic right of a person. Anesthesia and life-saving measures are essential for the practice of surgical specialties of Ayurveda, like Shalya Tantra, Prasuti Tantra, Shalaka Tantra, and others. To practice and promote these surgical specialties, use of certain modern tools, medicines, and life-saving measures are inevitable. It is difficult to practice these facilities of Ayurveda without help of above basic needs. In India, see, there are a good number of well-trained postgraduate Ayurvedic doctors are available in the above specialized area. Their expertise, skills, services are underutilized or unutilized because of the legal constraint existing in many states, and they are not permitted to use advanced anesthesia and other life-saving measures. This is not only restrict the proper use of highly trained manpower to serve the needy, suffering patients in the areas where already there is a huge shortage of specialized doctors to help the patients, but also at the same time, the specialized treatment procedure in surgical specialties of Ayurveda will also remain unexplored. That what we can see is that if you do not allow to practice, how can you develop a system? This trend will further strengthen the teaching, training, and practice of Ayurveda, especially in the field of specialized in specialties. Use of modern tools as well as advances in surgical practice facilitate to validate many Ayurvedic therapies and new treatment modalities. As I have shown you, that if you do not permit us to use it, how can you do it? You see, the strength. Another important aspect that in the National Health Program, where many of our graduates are participating. So they are using a few modern medicine and diagnostic tools. So the graduates are usually posted in rural area where they are only health provider. Therefore, adequate training should be given to them, you see, so that they can handle the critical situation and they can refer a patient to a referral area. So if a doctor is posted at a rural area and do not have a facility to support critical patients, then how can you save a human life? Therefore, there should be adequate training and they should be permitted to use certain tools and techniques to save precious human life. During the course of some catastrophe, you see this, like diagnostic procedures as I told you, that there may be emergency threatening. So at that point of time, you don't get another doctor to rescue you. So being a doctor, you need to rescue yourself. Therefore, so these life-saving measures must be there. During the time of natural calamities also, the ASU doctors, the Ayurvedic doctors are being utilized for treating victims. So if somebody is utilized for treating victims in a natural calamity or emergency situation, then they should also be permitted in other time also. My submission is that institutionally qualified and trained people, those who are specialized in practicing these areas, they should be permitted to use the advances in the sciences and tools and techniques in keeping the patient safe and proper. It will be very difficult to say without saying few words about this plastic and reconstructive surgery, which is done by Sushrut. I will end my talk with this very a video, which is quite long one, but just to see it for a few minutes. And this is end of my talk, you see. And there is a small video to share with you, which is something about the plastic and reconstructive surgery, which we did for some time, you see. We did it for BBC Channel 4 on plastic and reconstructive surgery, okay? And this is my my end of my topic, you see. So a video is there, you can see, and meantime you can also raise some questions if you like. Can you listen? Can you see the video? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, just a minute. Let me play it again. It's a video for reconstructing of bone. You see. It's a video which depicts, you see, the journey of plastic surgery in through ages. So we will start. You can see it and. It's a long video, but I'll just take you a few of the clips of it because it takes more than some 14 or 15 minutes. I feel it will be not suitable for you. But let us see some of the clips of it. It's a statue of Sushruta in our hospital. We did a plastic and reconstructive surgery of a nose of a patient, which are being lively demonstrated by us, where the surgical various instruments you can see. Then the patient who has a damaged nose. So we reconstructed this patient by taking a, of course, the flap was a cartilage taken from the ear, and then we have reconstructed. But the principle was like this. You see. Look at, you see, the tragedy, you see that the people, the plastic and reconstructive surgery was given by Ayurveda, but hardly there are few people can practice plastic surgery in Ayurveda now, because if you truly speaking, without anesthesia, it cannot be done. Same thing, the cataract surgery is being done by, given to the world by Sushruta, how to operate a cataract. And now there are a lot of queries arises if some Ayurvedic doctors operate upon a cataract patient. So that's the tragedy. So that it happened because we could not, you see, stand the law by the law, you see. There are many restrictions which restrict us to operate upon these patients. It is not always the principles or the practice or the techniques which has been described. Now it is a question how to carry out these things in today's context, you see. Today a patient cannot be operated without safe anesthesia, safe life-saving measures. So these are probably more essential component of our of today's practice, and this needs to be deliberated more right manner, in right spirit, you see, rather than it is a challenge from both inside the system of medicine as well as from outside the system of medicine. We are being challenged by both our own people as well as from the outside people. We need people need a safe anesthesia, safe life-saving measures, which is an essential component for practicing emergency, critical care, and surgical process. So this is a video. If someone used to see it, you can see it, you see, that basically mode a story how this plastic surgery developed in through the years, you see. And I can provide you the link if you someone wish to see it, you see. With these words, I thank you very much for listening me and giving me an opportunity to share my views and ideas about critical care in some of the areas where you can do something. The principles of Ayurveda, how they are applicable today, are they need some sort of advances, where we need advances, what are the advances we need. So these are some of the areas which I try to discuss with you. And if you have some queries or question, I'll be happy to reply. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. So I will mute my presentation. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for an excellent presentation.
Thank you very much.
Sir, we have few questions.
Sure.
Do you have some? Sir, the first question is, how to control PAKA internally as well as externally? What are the measures for it?
Let me just repeat the question once again.
How to control PAKA internally and externally?
How to control?
PAKA, sir, PAKA.
I just cannot get the point, you see.
Sir, control the PAKA of Vrana or...
Okay, sepsis, what you say that how to control sepsis, rather I will say more important, no, PAKA. Is it so? How to control PAKA?
Yes, sir.
Okay, it depends upon a situation, you see. See, if there is an abscess already separated, the simple thing, an adequate drainage is more than enough to control the infection or sepsis. But if there is a sepsis which is spreading, which is, I mean, at its different stages, you see, if it is a aam avastha or pachamana avastha or pakka avastha, if it is a pakka avastha, The treatment is quite simple and safe. You need to drain it. Adequate drainage is adequate, more than enough to control infection in most of the cases. If there is a pachaman avastha, there are local measures and there are systemic measures. The Sushrut has very specific in advising treatment of septic conditions. There are two situations. If it is associated with a vrana, so there will be a local management of vrana, and if it is associated with with local management as well as the vranit upachar, means the management of a wounded person. So we need to manage the local condition. We need to manage the person on which the patient. That involves your diet. That involves your some systemic medications. So that depends on a stage and the extent of a condition.
Okay, sir.
And let me tell you that in most of the clean surgical procedures, this what so-called antibiotic has a very little role to play. And more you become more mature than, and if your surgical procedures are very specific and clean, probably you need not require an antibiotic. Antibiotic is not for healing. Never. An antibiotic never heals.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more question. If a patient develops abscess at a surgical incision site, how to treat even after a few months?
These questions are again more relative. Relative in the sense, a surgical infection may develop simply because of a suturing material that remain inside the tissue. So you remove the small, you say, surgical, the foreign body which acts as a foreign body, the abscess will, the infection will control. Normally, once the wound heals, you see, normally don't remain as a persistent infection. It's a chronic infection. There is something which can cause, there may be some nidus. There must be something which is remaining inside which can cause an infection. So that need to be taken care of.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. I think that's all the time we have for questions, as our session is already delayed. Sir, gurus are people who has the capacity to open our eyes, and sir, you have opened so many eyes, has guided so many people into the pathway of Ayurvedic surgical management, and now us also. Thank you for sharing your wealth of knowledge in the short time with pictures, stage by stage explanations, and by sharing your clinical experience. Also, sir, thank you for presenting the BHU model platform for integrative care and the justification and plea for in favor of Tangyaharan. We are very fortunate to have you, sir. A sincere thank you from all of us here at ECCA.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Dear delegates, we have come to the end of the third day of the conference on emergency and critical care in Ayurveda, coordinated by AVPRF and AHET in association with IPGTRA, Jamnagar, and Ministry of Ayush. We hope that you had a wonderful day of learning from all the great masters whom we hosted today. The conference will continue tomorrow, our fourth and the last day of it. So tomorrow, Sunday, 28th June, the Zoom meeting room will open at 6:45. From 7 to 8, there will be a special puja from Thanvantari Temple, Ramanathapuram, Coimbatore. From 9, we will start the morning session. For that, the Zoom room will open at 8:45. Then there will be a lunch break. The post-lunch break session will start at 2:30 till 5:30. And 5:30, we will have feedback and conclusion with the Padma Shri Dr. Rajesh Kotecha, Secretary, Ministry of Ayush, and Padma Shri Dr. P.R. Krishnakumarji, Managing Director, the Ayurvedic Pharmacy, Coimbatore Limited. Thank you, everyone. Good night.